Welcome. You're listening to the PM Show. This is John from The Real Liberal, and it looks like any second now I will be joined by Danica. Amanda is taking the night off. She had some personal things to take care of, and I'm going to try to run the board. Hopefully, I do as well as Amanda does. Danica, are you with us?
All right, so I think you either muted the show or it just started recording because I heard the beep. But hello, everyone. I am here, and it is going to be amateur night here on the PM show.
It is, because I'm running the board and have no idea what I'm doing. So.
Ready for
but the intro music worked. If you didn't hear it, I swear it was on because I turned it on.
All right, well, I'll believe you.
Yeah. We'll find out at the end of the show when I download the recording and see if it came out. So we'll know in 2 hours.
Awesome. Can't wait. So excited. And good to have you on. This is the first time that we've ever done a show together. I know we briefly talked on the phone a few minutes ago before we did the show together. So it's nice to meet you. You know, I'm not sure if we said that over the phone, but yeah, this is the first time we've ever done a show together, and it should be interesting.
We'll see how well you do 2 hours later. How much you can tolerate.
I'll be like, John, no.
Now, when we were talking earlier, you did say something about Bitcoin. And
yes.
I'm one of these guys who huge supporter of Bitcoin, think Bitcoin is fantastic, even though there's some fighting amongst the libertarians about gold is better, Bitcoin is better. I'm one of these guys that says, hey, have a free market money. If you like gold better, use it. If you like Bitcoin better, use it. Why not?
Yeah, it's absolutely true. And I mean, you know, here, I know that you're not currently in New Hampshire. In New Hampshire, there is a strong alternative currency movement here. I know that in even other countries, such as, say, Russia and even China, there are some pushes for alternate currency. There are some people here that do prefer the precious metals. People frequently pay for agorist items in either silver, sometimes gold. But a big push is definitely for Bitcoin. Bitcoin is definitely the most popular of the cryptocurrencies at this point. A big thing that really people like about Bitcoin is that, for the most part, it's open source, that the code is out there and you can see transactions. But Bitcoin is instantaneous, so you don't need to wait for your bank to clear your money. Simply put, if I want to send you, John, $100 in Bitcoin from my wallet, and if I don't have $100, the transaction is just simply not going to go through. It's not going to pull my money and then charge me an overdraft. It's like, oh, hey, you don't have $100. You have $80. So then I'll be forced to retype whatever amount that I need to send you and send it that way. Bitcoin is also
Danica,
it's
now,
not,
are you making a claim here that you could have financial transactions and the big banks couldn't make all these junk fees? I don't know if they're going to go for this. This does not sound like this is going to go along with their business model.
The benefit to Bitcoin, though, is that it's not regulated by any sort of government, unlike the dollar that we know of. Bitcoin is its own and rises with, supply and demand with the market.
Yeah, well, no. I agree with everything you're saying. I was kind of being sarcastic because, like, with the big banks, they make a lot of money on, the junk fees. And so, like, if cryptocurrency takes over
–
these guys, this doesn't really go along with their business model, They need those junk fees. They make so much money every year. And I was reading a story about this a couple months ago. I can't remember what the number was, but it was ginormous. And they make a ton of money from junk fees.
Oh, yes, absolutely. If you look at any sort of bank, or credit unions to some degree, but not as much as banks. But if you're looking to open up a bank account at any bank, you'll see a pamphlet, and they'll give you, a lowdown of fees. Every bank nowadays has some sort of monthly fee, and obviously you can waive that fee with some sort of automatic transfer or certain amount of debits per month or something. The problem is that the bank is being forced by this by the U.S. government. They're not necessarily trying to enforce it, but just everything that they're having to make up to the government, they're forced to instill these fees. So it's certainly frustrating on both sides. Just today, I started a new job a few weeks ago, as most of you know, and while I'm waiting for my direct deposit to go through, I was issued a paper check today, and I was frustrated because I didn't want to take my lunch break to deposit it. It was drawn off of another bank that's here in town, And I was just thinking, well, I'll just go and present two forms of ID to the bank and get cash for it and then deposit cash. But then a quick Google search told me that the bank that it was drawn off of would charge me a $5 fee for being a non-member. You know, I'm just kind of like, okay, never mind then. So I ended up doing the mobile deposit and just waiting for the money to clear that way. And thankfully it cleared today. But yeah, there's really so much you have to do with banks nowadays. It's nuts that anyone, including myself, still has a bank account.
Yeah, I love that. And I never thought about this, or I guess I'd never realized it. But because Bitcoin acts like cash, if you don't have the money in there, it's just like, you're not going to get any fees because you can't withdraw it if it's not in there.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, it's also important that, you know, you obviously need to take precautions to keep your Bitcoin safe. Same as, you know, you would need to keep your debit card and credit card information safe, too.
Well, you know, I was reading something online a couple months ago about the Target breach. And
yes,
the person who was writing this article is pro-Bitcoin. And they're making a great case that if everyone would have used Bitcoin in that Target breach, the only thing they would have been able to get is the money for that transaction. That's all the money that they could have stolen. So beyond that, because it's like cash, so if your transaction was $17, that's all they could have gotten. They would have stole it from Target, not from you. They wouldn't have been able to go beyond that like they can with credit card and debit card numbers, which I thought was a really interesting argument for Bitcoin.
Yeah, that's a great argument if you think about it, because they wouldn't have been able to get access to all of those private keys. You know, they may have seen the codes, but those codes would not have gone anywhere if they didn't have the private keys. And as most of you know, the private keys are, you know, several times encrypted over. So you're right, the only transaction they would have been able to gotten would have been right there from Target, not from any of the users. That's a great argument.
I'm trying to remember where I read that. I think it was on LouRockwell.com, which I visit daily. Have you ever been to that site?
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah, Lou Rockwell's pretty awesome. I'm not surprised that it probably would have come from Lou Rockwell, actually.
His site, I love his site. It's, you know, it's like 10 articles every day. And I usually get mad because I'm like, I can't read all of them. So, because, you know, I have to pick and choose. You know, we all have limited time. But, yeah, I love that site. And Lou Rockwell's done great work with the Mises Institute. So, starting the Mises Institute. But, I love anything that guy does, and he's really been a great advocate for liberty all for years. I don't know how familiar.
Yeah,
you are
Lou
Rockwell
is really awesome. I've I've had the pleasure to talking with actually Bob Murphy at Porkfest a couple times. Really great guy, really smart, really down to earth. He's had his own variety hour. We did what's that? Not The Price is Right. What's that game? That family game? Family Feud. That's it. I just had to say the word family and it came up. But yeah, we played a libertarian version of Family Feud, and that was great fun. Really awesome guy. He usually goes to Porkfest. If you ever get a chance to come to Porkfest, definitely keep your eye out for Bob Murphy.
You know, I keep hearing about this Porkfest, and I've never been. I know it's kind of a big thing in the libertarian circles, but I have never been to Porkfest. It's one of those things I guess I need to do.
Yeah, I think everyone should try and make it to Porkfest at least once. I mean, you know, with everything, it's going to cost money, and it kind of sucks. But, you know, the benefit is that you can't, you know, if you can't afford a full campaign site, which, you know, many of us do, a lot of people there's enough to put maybe like five large tents on each camping site. And obviously, you know, not everyone's going to have a large tent, but there's plenty of room to put cars on each side as well. So, and it's joyous because it totally cuts down on the cost. People are, you know, almost everyone will take some sort of cryptocurrency. This year, of course, Bitcoin was is the primary cryptocurrency, but a number of vendors were accepting Dogecoin, Litecoin, as well as Darkcoin. Myself, I was accepting Bitcoin. I did take a couple of tips in Dogecoin, but I do want to see where Litecoin and Darkcoin go and then maybe see about offering those as well.
Now, Porkfest, where do they hold that every year?
They hold that in Lancaster, New Hampshire. It's roughly about 2 hours from the very southwest part of Keene.
So they call it Lancaster?
Yeah, it's called Lancaster, New Hampshire.
Oh, that's funny because, like, in South Carolina, we have a city called Lancaster, and that's how we pronounce it.
Lancaster.
I just thought it was
interesting.
Lancaster. Well, you know, it's really interesting. You go into different cities, and like Columbia, South Carolina, there's a place for Eugene Street, or there's a – hold on a second. I'm actually getting a phone call right now.
Oh, no. All right, well, while John is taking that phone call, I'm just going to talk a little bit more about Bitcoin just so that our listeners don't have to listen to extreme silence. You know, a lot of people think, well, what else can I use Bitcoin for rather than just, like, purchasing between, you know, aggress people? Well, there is this website called gift.com, and that's G-Y, not I, G-Y-F-T.com. It's gift.com. The neat thing about this is that you can buy a ton of different kinds of gift cards, whether it's Abercrombie & Fitch, even Amazon, I want to say Omaha Steaks, Kohl's, pretty much anything you want, down from food to clothing to even Walgreens and CVS, you can get a bunch of gift cards, and they even take Bitcoin. And the neat thing about Gift is that with every purchase that you make with Bitcoin, you accumulate points. I believe you accumulate points if you use other forms of currency as well, but I've only had to purchase it with Bitcoin. But if you pay with Bitcoin, you get a number of points per every transaction, and those points can be later redeemed for another gift card. So you're basically rewarding yourself back, which is really, really awesome. And the neat thing about it is that they've added vendors there that normally wouldn't be added anywhere else. And there's, you know, a couple of neat little hacks that me and my friends have decided about. So, for example, you can buy Target gift cards with Bitcoin. But you know, let's say you want to go to for example, you want to go have a meal at an Olive Garden, but Olive Garden gift cards are not available on Gift for whatever reason. You take your Target gift card that you purchased with Bitcoin and go and buy a Olive Garden gift coin with your Target Bitcoin. Yes, Target will allow you to use your Target gift card to buy gift cards. So it's a neat way to move around the system. In other Bitcoin news, there have been a couple of vendors that now accept Bitcoin. Square, which is a very popular form payment for a lot of people, is now allowing Bitcoin to be used, which means that you can start using your Bitcoin through Square or through Gift at Whole Foods, at Victoria's Secret, and at Kohl's. It's really, really awesome how so many businesses are now accepting Bitcoin. And coming in a few weeks, 1-800-Flowers is going to be accepting Bitcoin. So starting next Mother's Day, you can now buy flowers with Bitcoin for your dear old mother.
You should be paid as an advertising person right now
for all
these different companies.
I wish I were getting paid. I just think Gift is just really awesome. I mean, not only is it just like an app that you can keep all of your gift cards, because how many of us get gift cards for our birthdays and Christmas? I mean, I, for one, absolutely love gift cards. You know, you can't go wrong. I know it seems impersonal, but really I'm excited because I get to use it for whatever I need. So not only do I have like one app to keep all of my gift cards in, but I can use Bitcoin. So, you know, let's say you want to use Bitcoin to buy groceries. Well, get yourself an Amazon gift card and go shopping. Or, again, get it at Target and then, you know, go to Target, get what you need, and then use that Target gift card to buy another gift card somewhere else. Even Starbucks.
Huh, that's an interesting way to do it.
So, yeah, you know, Bitcoin, it was really weird. So the summer Bitcoin was faltering somewhere between, like, 590 and 600. It's been dropping down quite a bit, and I don't really know why. Some people had suggested that people were purposely selling Bitcoin low. I'm not sure why that was. They were just either trying to get rid of it or just trying to mass sell a bunch of Bitcoin. So Bitcoin was dropping almost to about $400. It has gone up to about $423 according to BitcoinAverage.com, and that's because of the new integration with PayPal, I believe.
Yeah, no, that's something I didn't know. I didn't know that it was integrating with Bitcoin, with PayPal. So is PayPal accepting Bitcoin, or how does that work?
Yeah, PayPal is accepting Bitcoin. So if you normally PayPal is kind of like a third-party system where you can link your checking account or savings account, send to PayPal. PayPal takes it and stores it and then gives it to the other person, such as like with eBay. That's how it's done. So it can do the same with your Bitcoin wallet as well.
Wow, interesting. Yeah, I use PayPal for a lot of stuff. PayPal, it's one of those things I was surprised for years, and they're finally starting to do it, why PayPal wasn't like everywhere. Like, you couldn't just go to the grocery store and use PayPal. But now, I don't know if you have have the app, but on the app you can like purchase things at like Home Depot with the PayPal app, which is pretty crazy.
Oh wow, okay. Yeah, I don't have the PayPal app. I use PayPal pretty infrequently. Usually it's just with like eBay or sometimes when booking travel because it's a little bit more secure. But now I guess I'll have to start using it more often. That's really awesome.
Yeah, well, now that they accept Bitcoin, you should be able to use, I would guess, the PayPal app and use your Bitcoin. But if somewhere, like say Home Depot doesn't take Bitcoin, you should be able to convert your Bitcoin basically by using the PayPal app, which would make sense to me.
Yeah, it's great. And, you know, it's neat that they're accepting Bitcoin in so many different ways. You know, obviously the very first vendor, the big name vendor that accepted it was probably Overstock, I want to say. And I think
yeah, I remember when
Overstock,
that happened.
Overstock has just been blowing up with sales with Bitcoin, and you know, other businesses have followed suit. It's great.
Yeah, why not? I mean, if you're going to accept a currency like the dollar and it's constantly devalued, I would much rather take the Bitcoin, which has the potential for going up. I mean, to me, it's like a no-brainer.
Yeah, and right now is a great time to buy. I realize $420 is kind of pricey for someone who may not be, not sure what they want to be doing. But the best thing about this is that, again, you don't have to buy a full Bitcoin. Bitcoin is, you know, it can be go all the way down to eighths of it. So you can get a fraction of a Bitcoin, you can get half of a Bitcoin, you can get a quarter of a Bitcoin, and that still amounts up, and then you can still use it to purchase things. And you can keep a clear track of it using the blockchain wallet app. I don't know what, you know, app you use to look at your Bitcoin, but I use blockchain. I've had, you know, pretty good success with it. I know some people have had a couple of issues with it, but there's numbers of steps that you can take to define the security in your blockchain. So I definitely would recommend blockchain.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting that the value increases and that kind of scares people. But if they knew anything of economic history, when we had the dollar on the gold standard, the actual value of the dollar would increase just normally. There was deflation. Products and services continued to cost less and less, and dollars became more and more. And all they did was, you know, instead of you paying a dollar for something, you paid a quarter or you paid 15 cents or whatever it was. Before we had this consistent inflation by the Fed. So it's really interesting. I love the idea that it's not centrally controlled, which almost every currency now is. There's a central bank that controls the currency and they can print basically at will. And Bitcoin, I love that it's limited. And I have a real problem with some of the – now, there's a lot of Austrian economists out there, not a lot, but there are several of them who don't like Bitcoin. They say, oh, it's not real money. But from my viewpoint, it meets all the criteria for money. I mean, it's easily divisible. It's widely accepted. It's a store of value. I mean, sure, it's not, you know, hard gold, but who don't like Bitcoin are gold bugs, like Peter Schiff.
Yeah, you know, that's interesting that they say that they don't like Bitcoin. Is it just because that there's a limitation to them, or what exactly is there beef with it?
Well, you can go on YouTube, and if you put in Schiff, Peter Schiff, Stefan Molyneux, or put in Peter Stefan, it'll probably come that way. But there's a Bitcoin debate between them, and Stefan Molyneux is for Bitcoin. And he makes all the arguments for Bitcoin. And Peter Schiff is a gold bug, and he makes all the arguments for gold. And the whole time it was driving me crazy. I was like, can't you two just agree that in a free society with a free monetary system, Peter would use gold because that's what he likes. And you know, Stefan would use Bitcoin because that's what he likes. And the two would actually, I think, work together because they keep each other in check. You know, if gold, if you end up producing too much gold, then people may go to Bitcoin. If Bitcoin becomes too deflated, then people may go to a currency. I really think that the competing currencies would actually keep all these different currencies from getting a hand because it would act as a natural check in the market because you would know that people are going to leave that currency if you produce too much of it.
Well,
and
you know, let's look at the European Union and see how they forced all of these countries to go to the euro and see how that happened. I mean, if they had just allowed to keep their own state's currency, I mean, it probably would not have crashed. What do you think about, I mean, what do you think about that?
Well, I don't know a lot about the euro. I know a little bit about the European Union. I understand what originally the euro started out, or the European Union started out, as just a way for people to move within borders more freely. That was the beginning of the European Union. Then it got into the monetary system. They said, well, let's have one single currency so that we don't have to worry about all these exchange rates, which some of the European Union opted out of, including mainly Great Britain, because they obtained the pound. And then you ended up getting into where now they actually have a legislative body that runs the European Union. But the euros, there's the ECB, and they're the central bank for the euro. The euro's done okay, but the only reason it's done okay is because it's going against the dollar and the yen and every other currency that is not backed by anything. So it's really a mixed bag, and when you start studying it, it gets really complicated.
Yeah, absolutely. That's crazy.
But for them, honestly, I've always had this question. No one's ever been able to answer this. But most of those countries run, not most of them, pretty much all of them run on Keynesian economics. So they believe the economy goes into a slump, you have to kick it forward through massive government spending or reduction in the interest rates through monetary policy. So you got to either use fiscal policy or monetary policy, different tools that they've got available. And of course, the Fed would use monetary policy. So, but the problem with the euro is, you can't inflate in one country without inflating in the other. So if you have a boom, say, in Spain, but you have a depression in Germany, well, then you got a problem, because Germany is going to engage in all sorts of deficit spending and all sorts of extra government programs. So I think that's a lot of reason the European Union has had so many problems. And they've never been willing to – I mean, you could keep the euro going – if they were all willing to constrain their spending. That's the problem Greece had. I mean, they all wanted to retire at like 55, and they didn't want to restrain any spending. So you've got the government, which is just going to keep spending and spending and spending without any constraints. And then that becomes problematic for other countries, because through inflation, they're basically subsidizing the country that refuses to restrain their spending. And that's always been problematic. And to me, it was always crazy that the European Union ever wanted a one monetary unit. It never made a lot of sense to me. Like, I never could understand the real argument for it, besides the ease of going from one country to another and not having to worry about exchange rates.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, good. You didn't go to sleep there. I thought maybe I went too long.
No. I mean, I definitely enjoy economics as well, and it's just, it's nuts how, it's really cool being able to talk to someone that has, just as much admiration for it as well, and can really talk to just the different kinds of currencies and the, the terrible inflation that's going on in one country versus another, and just the kind of backlash that's going to get from it.
Well, I mean, the basic problem you've got is almost every country now is a mobocracy, and the mob is always going to want more and more and more free stuff. The government's basically an auction block. And the government doesn't have enough political, they don't have enough, political will. There's a better term for this, political capital to raise taxes. But they have these constituents and these special interest groups who are always lobbying for more and more benefits, but don't want to pay the additional taxes. So printing the money is the best alternative. You don't have to raise taxes, but yet you can still give out all these government programs. And so basically that's what we've had. I mean, we've just had – well, even during Reagan, which the conservatives love and worship Reagan, even during the Reagan administration, you had massive deficits. I mean, I would and I think could make a good argument that the Reagan administration basically benefited from Keynesian economics. I mean, we were in massive deficit spending during the Reagan administration. They could blame the Democrats if they want to, but that's the facts. And from a monetary standpoint, now I will give Reagan this. he actually did stand by Volcker and raised interest rates. But that was because inflation was out of control at that point, and they had to do something. But as far as fiscal policy goes, it was definitely Keynesian. And they were also reducing taxes at the same time. So they're reducing the amount of money that actually came into the government coffers while they were increasing government spending, which is just pure Keynesianism. But like I said, the only credit I will give them is monetary policy was better then under Volcker. But that's only because Paul Volcker was an inflation hawk, and he wanted to stop the decline of the dollar. And, I mean, it took double-digit interest rates to do that. But I will say this, even though I think that system is horrible, at least that guy had enough guts to do that, and they did it. Now they won't do it. I mean, Janet Yellen and Bernanke have had interest rates at pretty much zero, where they've basically goosed the stock market prices. I mean, the stock market's not even stock anymore. It should be called the casino market because it's gambling. It's all day trade. Well, I mean, it really is. It's all about day trades. It's not about long-term growth anymore. It's not about, okay, let's build a business and pay good dividends on these stocks, and people believe in the business because it's healthy and it's ran well, et cetera. It's not that way anymore. It's all about the day trade. And all these companies are obsessed with is their stock prices. That's all they care about.
Yeah, and, you know, so many people will put so much value in these stocks. And, you know, I don't think they even, you obviously understand this, but the Federal Reserve itself is its own private entity. It's not necessarily, like, its own government building. It is, you know, controlling all of that money, all of that printing going on.
Well, yeah, they've pretty much since Bernanke and Greenspan, and I could be wrong, this could be worse, but they've at least quadrupled the money supply, because Greenspan doubled the money supply while he was at the Federal Reserve, and then Bernanke doubled it again. So it's been quadrupled in the last, I don't know, 15 years, and it may even be worse under Yellen. I haven't looked in a while, so I don't know how much money they printed in the last just few years. But a lot of people mistakenly think that even – and this drives me crazy – Even a lot of libertarians think, I hear them all the time say, the Federal Reserve is a private bank. It's not a private bank. It's a quasi-public private institution. Yes, the profits are privatized and there are private owners, but they have public appointees. So it's kind of like Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. It's almost like a GSC. Basically, is a GSC. But we're not the first ones that thought, like, we didn't come up with sponsored entities. You can go back to Hitler's Germany, and the Volkswagen was a government-sponsored entity. And even before him, Britain had the East India Company, and that was a quasi-government-funded, private, for-profit company. So this kind of stuff's been going on a long time. But it's basically crony capitalism. But they give this bank the special privilege of printing this money, and they control the money supply, which is extremely dangerous. But only the crazy libertarians are the ones saying, hey, this is nuts to let one entity control the entire money supply. And it makes a lot more sense, and it's not clear wacko. It's actually rational to say we should have a free market money where no one entity controls the quantity of money, because that's where you get into all these different problems, is when you have one entity controlling everything.
No, oh, yeah.
That's my rant on the Federal Reserve.
No, that's great. I mean, I think it's very important to hear about that, because, yes, it is absolutely dangerous to have just one entity controlling the money, because, you know, who knows when it's just going to spontaneously combust, for sure.
Well, I'm really worried. I do think we've got a bubble in the stock market. There's no doubt the economy sucks, but the stock market is through the roof right now, which is insane. And, you know, we've seen the bubble before, and I think with the housing market and the tech sector, we still had enough of a real economy to withstand all the negative consequences from that in the aftermath. And now we've gotten to a point where I don't know that we can, like, the economy can withstand those negative consequences, because at least when we had those negative consequences from the other bubbles, they blew up. At least people had jobs at the time and had savings and all that. Now, all that's gone now, and most people are just getting by. So I don't know if we can withstand another jolt to the system. That's the thing that scares me the most about the stock market right now. Like, when it comes down, what's going to happen? And then you've got, I don't know if you know David Stockman is, but Dave Stockman was an economist under under Reagan. He's a classical, but he pretty much leans, if not is all the way there. He's pretty much Austrian. But he thinks you're going to end up with massive asset deflation. So, like, you paid, and right now, like, I'm familiar with the Charlotte market for the housing market. Right now, it's crazy. A tiny little 1,200-square-foot house, two-bedroom or three-bedroom, two-bath, or three-bedroom, one-and-a-half-bath, old ranch-style house built in the 50s. Sure, it's been remodeled, but it's not, you know, Shangri-La. $215,000 for that, for a tiny little house in Charlotte, North Carolina.
Yep.
Now, I mean, he thinks there's going to be massive asset deflation. So under that scenario, you buy a house for $215,000 because the market's crazy right now here. You buy the housing market, you buy a house for $215,000. All of a sudden, you find out a year from now, there is massive asset deflation. Your house is worth $120,000. You're stuck with almost $100,000 in lost value.
Yeah, and don't even get me started on the property taxes, especially, you know, here in New Hampshire. New Hampshire doesn't have a lot of taxes, but property taxes is one of the highest they have here. And, you know, I have been thinking about, you know, possibly buying a house, you know, at some point in the next years, and I just every day see the disadvantages of having a house. I'm really kind of nervous against that because, like you said, just the decreasing values, the houses are, you know, have this bubble and they're artificially high, plus paying the crazy amounts of taxes for that. It's just, it, you know, it's just mind boggling. I'm not sure if I want to do it.
Well, here in Charlotte, I'm actually in Charlotte, North Carolina now, but here in Charlotte and a lot of places in South Carolina, the taxes are really high. Like, you can have $1,000 mortgage, and by the time you add in your insurance and taxes, your mortgage is now about $1,400, with the bulk of that being taxes. I mean, like a third of your payment now is tax. I mean, it's just pure insanity. And I don't know exact numbers. I'm sure for depending on where you are in North Carolina, it's probably for different places. But it's not good. And I really worry about these the housing values being pushed up and the stock market, too, being pushed up to the point when it does crash, there's going to be a problem. And now I'm surprised in New Hampshire. I thought you guys had all these, like, liberty people there in New Hampshire. What's going on with tax rates?
No, I mean, we do have a lot of liberty people. And the nice thing about New Hampshire is that it's already, like, very freedom-oriented. I mean, I see it here in everyday life as well as in my own work, just how, you know, they're very kind of hands-off and let people kind of do what they own. And that if a particular individual messes up, then they deal with that individual person. They don't put everyone under the same bubble, so to speak. So, for example, two main big taxes in New Hampshire that we have been, you know, trying to lobby as much as we can have been prepared food taxes, such as, say, hot foods at grocery stores or restaurants, have a 9% tax. Other than that, there is no sales tax on groceries. There's no sales tax on clothes. There's no sales tax on, you know, virtually everything else. There's no income tax either, so you get more take-home pay, but the property value.
Oh, really? New Hampshire doesn't have an income tax.
New Hampshire does not have an income tax. No. The big
wow,
thing about the property taxes is what. Neither did I, and that was really nice being able to have more take-home pay. One thing that I found out, and this is, you know, I'm gonna go, you know, go saying, I would not register your car in New Hampshire because they consider cars part of the property taxes. So there is yearly inspection fee that you have to do. It usually ranges between $20 and $30 depending on where you are. Plus you have to have, you know, you have to pay for your car every single year. And obviously the newer the car is, the more hits you're going to take because it's a certain percentage of the year plus every year following that. So they start at 2010 and then they just add on to the prices from that. Thankfully, I still have about another year to go on my previous registration. So I don't have to worry about that yet. But when that time comes, I'm going to see if maybe I can just re-register it back in Idaho, maybe under my parents' address, and avoid paying the high property taxes. So that's one way that we can get out of paying high taxes.
Well, yeah, I was hopeful with the Free State Project. Like, there was would be a lot of new members elected to their house and, you know, with their state house so that there would be less taxes. Is it just not – there's not enough of you yet?
I don't think it's necessarily that. I think it's just it's a very long road to go through. I mean, the Free State Project, I believe, was started in 2003 or 2004. So it's only been, you know, it's only been going on for the last 10 years. Already we have, you know, almost 2,000 people, I believe 1,600 people or something like that. We have like 1,600 people already here as early movers. We have 16, almost 17,000 signers. And once we have the 20,000, we're going to try and really trigger the move, push the move to have people really move up here. I mean, there's tons of Liberty people already making, trying to make less taxes here. Last year there was the Thanks But No Tanks protest, which is, you know, trying to prevent the cities from getting spending money on Bearcats, which they did, you know, an armored vehicle militarization of police in our cities. That was successful to some degree, although the city of Keene did try to push to have the Bearcat come back. But, you know, there's tons of protests for the prepared food tax. It's still, you know, it's definitely something in the works and definitely something that we're all trying to fight. And many of us, you know, avoid paying it by trying to, you know, cook more food at home.
Well, now, have you ever heard of this Democrat named Cynthia Chase there in New Hampshire?
Oh, do I know who Cynthia Chase is?
I thought I'd bring, because I remember, I just Googled for it, because I remember a year or so ago, I read this article, and I was blown away by what this woman said. She's a Democrat, for those who don't know, in New Hampshire, and this is what she said. This was December 21st, I think last year, year before last. This is 2013. She said this. She said we need to restrict the freedoms of people so that we'll make the free staters and other conservatives uncomfortable. But I'll read the actual quote because I think it's great. In the opinion of this Democrat, free staters are the single biggest threat the state is facing today. There is legally nothing we can do to prevent them from moving here to take over the state, which is their openly stated goal. In this country, you can move anywhere you choose, and they have the same right. What we can do is to make the environment here so welcoming that some will choose not to come and some may actually leave. One way is to pass measures that will restrict the freedoms that they think they will find here. Another is to shine the bright light of publicity on who they are and who are coming. But I think that's really funny is like, she's like, well, let's just pass like freedom killing laws and we'll get rid of these people, which I can't believe she's so blatant about it. I guess I shouldn't be surprised, but what do you know about Cynthia Chase?
I was just actually going to bring that up, but it looks like that you've done your homework already by saying that she wants to restrict the freedoms that we have and make it seem like, oh, this really isn't the best place for you to be here. And, you know, it just, it's mind-boggling. Just, you know, it's funny because she realizes that we're a threat, that, you know, the ways that, you know, she could be earning less money, which I'm not sure why she's worried about it, because the representatives here, because New Hampshire is so small, they, you know, only make, I believe, $200 per term. So they have to have a full-time job to pay the bills, or, you know, maybe they're retirees and can, you know, devote all their
time. Well, yeah,
it
sounds like the free staters got their way. She'd be out of a job, so maybe that's what she's worried about.
Pretty much, yeah.
I mean, you would vote her out, wouldn't you, if you could? I would, based on that statement.
Nah.
I don't vote.
I know. Yeah, exactly. And I just, you know, it's just crazy. You know, I can't wrap my head around how she thinks that she's going to, like, purposely try and make it seem like, oh, it's a bad idea to move here. You shouldn't move here. And really, it's just, it makes me go, what? But, you know, I think a lot of people can just totally see through her BS and just be like, all right, Cynthia Chase. A woman you do have to worry about, though, is Susan the Bruce. I would definitely recommend Googling and looking at her blog. And she's just, yeah, she really does try to attack free staters.
But don't look at her pictures.
Susan the
Bruce?
Look
at her blog, but not
Chase?
Her pictures. No, Cynthia Chase. She's a very unattractive woman. Just read the blog.
Yeah.
And that's probably all you need to do. I'm actually looking at her picture right now, and I'm going to scroll down so I don't have to look at her anymore.
I was actually, when I first saw her, I asked a friend of mine, I was like, is that a man or a woman?
Oh, God.
I know. I'm a terrible person. I was like, you know, she has a female name, but, you know, something isn't right here.
Yeah, there's a lot wrong. Well, on that note, Danica, which we've had some fun thus far, let's take a break real quick, and we'll come back, and we'll talk about I don't know, whatever. We've got a whole bunch of stuff. What do you want to talk about when we come back? Think about that. I'm going to think about what we're going to talk about. We've got a bunch of stuff. I know we want to talk about the government bombing the crap out of whoever is the new target.
Syria.
I think ISIS, ISIL. I don't know. Whatever we're calling these people now. So we want to talk about that. And I know I definitely want to talk about the Pirate Bay at some point and the good work that those folks are doing. And the secession movement. We want to talk about the secession movement. So there's a lot of stuff we can get into. So I guess we'll take a break now. And we'll come back in just a few minutes and talk some more.
All right.
Constitution like the back of your hand. You've read books, listened to podcasts, attended lectures, surfed websites, and watched videos. You've made liberty your life's goal, but something seems to be missing. Stickers from libertystickers.com. Exercise your freedom of speech with the world's most dangerous bumper stickers. That's libertystickers.com. But wait. There's more. You can buy Liberty stickers wholesale. Get them for 99 cents each when you put 100 or more in your shopping cart in any combination. Sell them or give them away. They're great for gun shows, flea markets, fairs, outreach, and more. Earn extra money, promote freedom, and spread the word. Need custom stickers, labels, or decals for your organization or business? Liberty Stickers makes them. Go to libertystickers.com to order or call 877-873-9626. Libertystickers.com, the world's most dangerous stickers.
Did you see this? The EPA wants to regulate water in our ditches now. Our ditches are dry most of the time. There's hardly ever any water in them. That's enough.
Government anyway. EPA, it's time to ditch the rule. Ditchtherule.fb.org. This is a message from the Missouri Farm Bureau. Contact them at 573-893-1558.
Everyone to the PM show. I am one of your, simultaneously rotating co-host, Danica, and we've got John back here, hopefully.
Oh, I'm here.
I didn't tell you a lot that you are here. All right, awesome, you're here. And if you're just tuning in, this is Amateur Hour here at the PM show. Mandy is off getting some personal stuff done. You know how all that goes. So John is back from his, you know, indefinite hiatus. I believe you were trained to be a rodeo clown of some kind. We're having a lot of fun.
It didn't work out, sadly, so I'm back.
Oh, darn.
I was
so looking forward to, you know, those trips.
I tried really hard. I thought that I would make it. Like, I got there. It was almost like American Idol, you know. I was like, there at the end, I didn't get picked. I was like, it's devastating. Very difficult.
Well,
I don't want to talk about
try
it.
You can try and high five a blind guy.
All right,
no,
so what do we want to talk about next?
Well, let's see. We've been talking about Bitcoin.
We've
been having like a lot of discussion about economics. We talked about taxes, and we've been talking about some reps that have been wanting to take away the freedoms of others. So we're on to some pretty heavy stuff tonight. I know that we had been talking briefly last night about, you know, who the U.S. is bombing now. I believe that was something that you wanted to discuss, and you said that it was probably ISIS, which is true. They are trying to bomb ISIS, and I believe they're going after one of their headquarters in Syria. So what do you got about that?
Well, you know, I haven't kept up with the latest group that Washington, D.C. has identified that we must bomb and mutilate. So I'm going to just claim ignorance right now. All I know is that, given their history, they want to bomb and mutilate anyone they can. But from what I understand, this new group is called ISIS or ISIL. And they can't – I don't know – do you know why they can't decide on a name? Normally they know. It's like it's Al-Qaeda. You know, they know.
Well, no,
like,
it is ISIS. It's the, it is ISIS that they are going after. And it's been going around for, I want to say, about – maybe 2 months. I'm not sure exactly when, but ISIS has been grabbing a lot of headlines because they've been threatening the U.S. with, you know, trying to stay out of their country. And of course, you know, the U.S. likes to butt their heads in just about everywhere they can. But they really gained attention when they started showing viral videos of U.S. and British journalists getting beheaded on live camera.
Okay.
You were silent there for a little bit, John. I'm not sure if you believed what I was saying.
No, I totally believe what you were saying, but I was trying to listen to that, and I clicked on this link from the single trip for Obama to play pool, drink beer, and raise money, cost taxpayers $700,000. And then this annoying guy, I hate these new websites. They start talking to you. So I was trying to figure out, and I've got like 18 tabs open. So I'm like, I'm listening to you, trying to, and I'm like going, okay, which freaking tab is it so I can shut this hole up? I hate those people.
You should be multitasking when you're on the air, John. How unprofessional.
It's horrible, I know. I was trying to do three things at once. I was trying to do two. So, yeah, you know, I don't know. I guess I have this negative viewpoint of the federal government where I just don't believe anything they tell me anymore. I just don't believe anything. So I'm not even sure
who
we're bombing early. What's that?
I said, well, you wouldn't be the first.
Well, you know, I mean, I just like, okay, we bombed the crap out of Al-Qaeda for like, I don't know, what is it, 10 years now? Okay. And were they the Taliban or were they Al-Qaeda? We had some confusion on that too before. But
I think they
it
were
just got to the
groups.
Point where they are separate groups technically from what I understand. It's such a, I don't know, it's so confusing when you get over there. Maybe we should just leave those people alone. That's my thing. Hey, let's trade, be friends with people. And stay out of entangling alliances, you know. Leave them alone. Let them live their
right.
life.
Right. It really sucks. It really sucks seeing that there are innocent people getting hurt right now. But, you know, if we would just stay out of other people's governments and let them take care of themselves, then we probably wouldn't be having all these issues. And, you know, besides, the U.S. has so many issues right now. We have no business interfering with others. I don't understand how they don't get it.
Oh, you know, and on top, you know, and this is one thing I wanted to stand up and cheer and do cartwheels every time Ron Paul would say this. But, you know, it's true. He said this during his last campaign. We're broke, okay? We don't have the money for all this adventurism. But you know, we're going to spend it anyways. We're going to print it and spend it. But we don't have the money for it.
No, they just
send
the order
broke.
To the Federal Reserve, and they just keep chucking out the funds.
Write us a check. I need like a friend at the Federal Reserve, somebody can give me some money when I'm in a pinch, you know, and be like, hey, listen, can you write me a check for like, I don't know, $500,000? Is that asking too much?
Oh, really? I'd be fine with just $20,000, but I guess, you know, you're just selfish.
Oh, sorry. I am. Well, we talked about Ayn Rand earlier, so I am selfish and key. I want that $500,000. I'm just not willing to steal it from people.
Yeah,
on any level.
Through the force of taxes or anything.
Now, I want someone to explain this, and a lot of people have talked about this before, so this is nothing new. But I just want to know, how in the heck did this guy get the Peace Prize? I mean, especially now. I mean, even then, how did he get the Nobel Peace Prize? He's bombed – since he got in office, he's bombed 7 or 8 countries now. I don't know. I'm starting to lose count of so many. And he bashed Bush for everything, you know, about the war, et cetera. And he's done everything they bashed Bush about. I mean, he is George W. Bush, but worse.
Oh, yeah.
It's like Lou Rockwell said one time.
He is just an incarnation of them.
Well, you know, Lou Rockwell one time said, what is it every president that makes you yearn for his predecessor? This is so true because, like, every one of these jerks are worse than the last one. I mean,
I don't understand how he got elected for a second term with all of the lies that he spread through his first one. Like, it boggles my mind how he was reelected.
Well, you know, at least with Clinton, all we were obsessed with is his sex life. I mean, that's all anybody could talk about, him and Monica Lewinsky. I would go back to those days in a heartbeat. I mean, I think Clinton was better than Bush and Obama. It was awesome. All we could talk about is the stained dress. I mean, that was like, you know, that was the news of the day. And the economy was pretty good under Clinton. Now, granted, he did benefit from a bubble. Between, you know, him and Greenspan cooked up a good bubble, but you know, and hey,
humans, I think we like to live in a bubble sometimes.
Well, yeah, as soon as Clinton got out at the perfect time, that was beautiful. He got out right before everything, you know, went to crap. So Slick Willy, perfect timing. And I'm actually going to, and this might shock you, but I'm actually going to support Hillary Clinton for president in 2016.
Oh, my goodness.
Absolutely. Can you imagine if we get somebody in there who really actually wants to change something? Like,
does
for example, let's say, for example.
No.
That's what's beautiful about her. She'll keep going with the same crap, and the right wing won't go back to sleep. Like, if you give him a Republican like Mitt Romney, who is basically a Democrat, but he has an R beside him. So the right goes, all right, it's all collectivism. Actually, it's so funny. Because all the Republicans I know think of themselves as individualists. Being a Republican is the most collectivist thing you can be. Being part of this party system is the most collectivist you can be. because you cheerlead for your guy because he has a little R beside his name, because he's on your team or she's on your team. And so you cheer. Even if this person is totally opposite of your values and your beliefs, doesn't matter. They have the little R beside their name. So what happens if Mitt Romney, or even if Rand Paul, say, for example, got elected? The right wing's going to go back to sleep. I want Hillary Clinton to finish the job. We got to drive this country into the ground to the point where people are willing to accept some alternatives, because right now they're not. And which blows my mind, as crappy as the economy, you would think that they'd be willing, you know, to like, okay, let's try something different. Hell, they won't even let Rand Paul won't even get elected. And he's like the most watered down midway between Republican and Libertarian you can find. I mean, granted, he's better than all the rest, which tells you how bad all the rest are. But still, I don't know. What do you think about Rand Paul? Are you a big Rand Paul supporter? No, or hate him, love him?
Oh, no. I mean, Rand Paul's definitely not like his dad. I, you know, don't agree with any of his views whatsoever. And, you know, he has, you know, told people that he is not a libertarian, yet so many people think that he is a libertarian. It's just like, no, he is, you know, almost, you know, he's got some views of his dad, but he is not like his dad at all. Please stop, you know, comparing him to his father. He is not his dad, nor will he ever be. He is someone completely different.
Well, you know, he has these libertarian leanings. I will give him that. And that's the most I call him, his leanings. But, you know, he got frustrated. There were some people who were giving him a hard time. I can't remember when this was. This was a few months back. But they were giving him a hard time about not being hardcore enough. Like, you know, like, because he'll vote for sanctions and stuff, which, of course, a lot of libertarians see as an act of war. You know, and he told him, and I get it. He got really frustrated with the person that was questioning him. He said, look, he said, I'm like giving them a halfway. Like, it's not full libertarianism. It's not conservative. It's like, I can't even get these guys halfway. What do you want me to do? And I mean, I can understand that frustration, but that also tells you how bad the country sucks. I mean, as watered down libertarian as Rand Paul is, and he can't even get the Republicans to vote with him on anything. You know, and he will vote with them sometimes. But, I mean, there are some times when Rand says things that I agree with and I think he makes sense. Then there's other times where I want to strangle him to death. So, it depends on the day.
Yeah, so, you know, maybe he has libertarian leanings. And maybe he doesn't. He hasn't impressed me thus far with his stances. The only thing that I would really kind of support him on is that he didn't necessarily think that companies should necessarily have to label their foods with GMOs, because he was just like, well, it's not up to the government to force them to do that. They should just be wanting to do that because they want to please their customers, because their customers want to be able to find foods that don't have any GMOs. On that topic, you know, why should the government have to label anything? Because we all know that they approve of so many things to eat, and you know, you could be easily eating something that has fecal matter from an animal that is used to make it taste good. So why are we trusting the FDA at all?
Yeah, you know, I mean, he says certain things, like he came up with the idea for freedom zones in Detroit. And I thought, you know, hey, that's a bad idea. I don't know if you're familiar with it. Basically, he was saying that we could have these zones set up. If you become an entrepreneur, you don't pay any taxes. So for a certain period. And I think his goal in that was to say, here's a model. Look, if we could revive Detroit, we could revive any place. So, and if they did something like freedom zones, and which they won't do it, but if they did it in Detroit would come back to life. I really think it would come back to life, but they're never going to allow that. It's kind of like a couple years ago, there was a congressman who was doing a tax cut or a rebate check or a stimulus, stimulus package. What he wanted to do is say, okay, look, 6 months, no one pays income tax or any other tax on their payroll. No payroll tax, 6 months. And, of course, he couldn't even get that out of committee. Now, why is that? Well, to me, it's simple. You go 6 months without income taxes, right? And then all of a sudden the government, oh, by the way, the 6 months is up. Now you got to start paying income tax again. People are going to flip out because they're actually going to see how much money they should be making. Their take-home pay is going to be their real check, not just what they get left over after the government takes their cut. And I think what would happen, they knew what would happen. People would flip out. And they don't want that. They do not want people to realize the enormous amount of money they're paying in taxes. Because a lot of people, which I have never understood this, they just look at their take-home pay. All my take-home pay is 800. Now, their real check was, you know, 1,050 or whatever. But all they see is, oh, you know, my check's 800 bucks.
Oh, my check is only $800. Dang, that must be nice. So, basically going on what you were saying about that, you know, Rand Paul is kind of leaning towards his father. There are, you know, 8 different ways that Rand Paul is different than Ron Paul. So Rand Paul is a lot more compromising and pragmatic. Ron Paul often won a claim for never voting a tax increase or for any bill not specifically authorized by the Constitution. But Rand Paul has indicated interest on compromising on matters from immigration reform to health care. He also made efforts to compromise his own party by working with AIPAC and allowing some foreign aid to countries considered pro-American.
I don't know if I disagree with any of that technically. I mean, I don't know all his voting record. I do know that sometimes he votes good and sometimes it's not so good. But what's sad is that he's still the best of that. I mean, he's the best what the Republican Party has to offer, which is how pathetic the Republican Party is. What a desolate
party. Well, I don't know. I'm still a little bit uncertain about him. I mean, he can't be, you know, any worse than Sarah Palin and John McCain or something. But I mean, when it comes down to it, both Democrats and both Republicans are very anti-liberty and anti-freedom. So, I mean, I don't believe in the voting for the lesser of two evils. I just, you know, if you don't want to go with the two-party system, don't fucking vote.
Yeah, I mean, it's if you don't vote, to me, that's a way in which you protest. I haven't voted. Well, I did vote in a special election for Mark Sanford. I haven't voted in a general election or a presidential election since 2000. Yeah, so it's been 14 years. I mean, I just don't vote because there's no point in the system. The system is corrupt. And you know what's really funny about what you were saying just a minute ago is whether you're Republican or Democrat. But, you know, Republicans run around and they think that, oh, yeah, we're the party that believes in freedom. And especially, like, if you meet, like, these mainstream Republicans, they're so diluted. They actually truly think they believe in freedom. Then you meet somebody from the left that's a Democrat, and they're like, well, you know, I think, you know, XYZ social policy is good. And so they think they're the freedom fighters. And it's so funny how deluded they are when neither one of those type people ever make the connection that, wait a minute, does this require the use of force? Oh, it does. Well, if it requires the use of force, how can it be free? Like, they have no philosophical standard for what they – like, they have zero philosophy. But they don't have one, like, philosophical principle that they can point to and say, this is what we believe and this is why we believe it. Like, I think – and that's the thing that attracted me to libertarianism when I was younger, was that there was philosophical underpinnings for what was being said. It wasn't simply like, I believe X, Y, Z on this issue – ABC, this issue, etc. It was, I believe in this principle, this philosophical concept. And because of that, everything else flows from that. And like, I was a big fan of Ayn Rand, still am. And of the basic libertarian tenet of the NAP, non-aggression principle. If you refuse to use violence against others and you don't recognize their right to use violence against you, so you believe in the non-aggression principle, no aggression, then all sorts of things flow from that. And that's what ends up making you a libertarian. And I think really that's the right way. Like, it makes sense. It's almost like it's one step after another. It's almost like it's numeric. It's, you know, it's one step following the step before. Whereas conservatives and liberals, modern day status liberals, they like have all these different beliefs on different issues, but they don't have any one thing that underpins everything they believe. Have you ever found that frustrating when you're talking to them? They'll believe in freedom on one issue because they think, oh, well, we should do this here. But then you ask them something else, and they're like totally tyrannical.
Well, and that's the thing again that differentiates both Rand Paul and Ron Paul is that, you know, for example, income tax, you know, by force is that you're stealing money from people. So Ron Paul has said that the national income tax should be should repeal it and replace it with nothing, whereas Rand Paul does want a fair tax with 17% for individuals and supports eliminating most of it. So, you know, he is for taxation. He also wants to have some prohibition on drugs, whereas Ron Paul has suggested that he wants a decriminalization on narcotics on a federal level. So Ron Paul and, you know, Rand Paul definitely differentiate drastically on that. You know, Ron Paul, you know, wants the drug war lifted. He doesn't want any more fight over it. He also doesn't want any more income tax, whereas Rand Paul wants both of those. He wants to have some sort of regulation on drugs. He also wants to have individuals be taxed. So in a sense, I mean, Rand Paul could eventually be pushing some sort of, you know, non-aggression principle, you know, violating that to some degree with pushing for taxes and still pushing for some sort of prohibition. Yeah.
Well, I mean, he admits that he's more of a moderate when it comes – he's somewhere between a Republican and a Libertarian, and he's not near like his dad. I mean, his dad was a hardliner. I've actually never campaigned for anyone in my entire life, and I campaigned for Ron Paul in 2012 in Charleston. It was a fantastic experience. It was great. People were great. It was fun. It was a really good experience. Even though he didn't win, it was still a great experience. But, yeah, Ron Paul, he appeals to the hardliners. He appeals to the people who are philosophically consistent. Rand doesn't. And Rand, I don't really truly believe he's trying to, because I hate to say it, but with the hardliners like us, we're the minority. The average Joe is more of a pragmatist.
It's funny that you mention campaigning. You probably aren't very familiar with New Hampshire candidates or anything, but have you ever heard of Scott Brown?
Yeah, I've heard his name. I don't know much about him, though.
Yeah, he was trying to run for governor, I believe, of New Hampshire, next to Maggie Hassan and Ian Freeman.
I remember this. Well, and Ron Paul actually came out and supported him publicly, didn't he?
That was Rand, not Ron. Ron would not support him, I don't think.
Okay, it was Rand who supported him.
Yeah, Rand was there. I do have a couple pictures of my friends that did take pictures along with Rand, with the, you know, they're saying, "I stand with Rand," and we're like,
I didn't follow that election closely. Who won?
Maggie won.
Maggie who?
Maggie Hassan.
Yeah, I vaguely remember that. There's too much in my small brain at this point in my life.
Right. I mean, it was just the primaries. I mean, there's still another chance for, you know, the close and runner-ups to go for again. But what I was trying to, you know, make a funny point about the campaigning is that we have, you know, most of us in the freedom movement do not care for Scott Brown because he is very anti-liberty and very anti-freedom. So a bunch of them went to his campaigns and protested by saying, "If it's Brown, flush it down. If it's Brown, flush it down." And it was hilarious.
That's great. Yeah, I mean, I remember when I was, like, working for the Ron Paul campaign, there was just, like, it was crazy stuff that would go on. I mean, people would show up, like, at Lindsey Graham and protest him, or they would show up at, not Sarah Palin, who was the one who was running at the time. The Republican Party always trots out these good-looking older ladies. Michelle Bachmann. Or, not Michelle Bachmann, what was her name?
Bachmann.
Dang it, that's another...
Michelle Bachmann.
I was mixing, yes, Michelle Malkin and Michelle Bachmann together. But, yeah, I remember they went down and protested her and held up Ron Paul signs while she talked. And they would just do crazy stuff like that. It was fun. And some of the other candidates would get mad. But I was like, come on, guys. I have a sense of humor. But we would show up and just, you know, and sometimes not even protest, but just hold up Ron Paul signs at someone else's campaign event. And it was, like, funny. And they would get mad at us. I mean, there were times when people were threatened to be removed from the premises. And I was like, come on, guys. It's not that big of a deal. But it was a fun time. It's definitely fun.
Yeah, it's really awesome. I've never campaigned, but it looks like it would be fun. I don't know. I mean, I don't like hanging around people.
Well, there's
but
this
I don't
camaraderie.
Really believe it because you can't. Yeah.
It was just fun. Like, we went to Myrtle Beach for the debates. And we stood out there. I remember me and one of the girls from the office, we went to the debate that was in Myrtle Beach, and when we got done, we walked outside, and a bunch of Ron Paul supporters we didn't know, they were from somewhere else, we didn't care. We held up signs with them as people walked by. I mean, we were the biggest contingent there. It was great. Like, it was so pathetic. The other the other candidates had, you know, it was like crickets. You know, they had two guys, two kids they probably hired that were standing out there with signs. And, you know, we were like screaming and holding up the signs and we were all chatting and it was social and it was a lot of fun. I remember one time we went downtown Charleston and we were canvassing. And so we're knocking on doors and I remember I was with one of the guys from the office and we walked by this van. And it had a Ron Paul huge magnet on the side of it, like kind of like the magnet I had on the side of my car, because, you know, you can buy the big magnets. Well, anyways, we walked by. It's like a hippie van, and these kids were standing outside. They were like college-age kids. I don't know. They're like 19, 20-year-old. And we struck up a conversation. We're like, oh, man, you guys are Ron Paul supporters. You know, we're out canvassing for Ron Paul. And I asked him, I said, man, where did you get that magnet? I said, you know, I've got one just like that. And the guy goes, yeah, we took it off that car over there, that gray car. And he pointed at my car.
Oh, my gosh.
It was fantastic. It was my car. He was like, yeah, we just took it. I was like, he's like, I'm sure that person doesn't mind. I was like, actually, that's my car, and I don't mind, man. It's totally cool. He's like, no, man, I'll give it back to you. I was like, don't worry. It's awesome. It was so cool, though, because they were so excited to see a Ron Paul mat that they stole it off somebody's car. They stole it off my car. It was brilliant. It's so much fun. And so we ended up sitting there talking to those guys for like a half hour, you know, just, you know, talking about like different issues and different things. And, you know, they were more like left libertarians, but it was like, it was interesting because even though we might've disagreed on some of the issues, we all agreed that basically the government should stay the hell out of it. And we should do whatever we want to do as long as we don't harm anybody else. And we could not, it was great being around people who could not even understand how someone could have a different point of view than that. Like, because I have a different point of view, you should be able to throw me a cage if I'm not hurting anyone. And it was great to be around that kind of stuff. I loved it. It was fantastic.
Yeah, that would have been hilarious. I mean, Mom has done tons of campaigning for Republicans back then. I don't know if you remember, like, Bob Dole or who, you know, there was another Herman Cain. She's
now,
done.
Did you,
you know,
did you campaign for Bob Dole, or did you say your
My mom did. Okay. My mom was really. My parents are both like very staunch Republicans. I was, you know, too young to do so, but I, you know, do remember them being very involved in that.
Yeah, I had a buddy of mine who I was somewhat political at the time, but was kind of, I was like, how old was I? It was when Pat Buchanan ran. That was 96 when Buchanan ran. I had a buddy of mine who's a hardcore Buchanan supporter. He's the Southern Nationalist I was telling you about on the phone. But hardcore Buchanan supporter. And he campaigned for Buchanan. And, of course, they gave it to Dole. I mean, God, what a horrible pick. Bob Dole. I mean, Bob Dole doesn't. And he retired from office and sold Viagra pills on TV. I mean, I don't know if anyone else finds that not so inspiring, but I did not find that inspiring at all. he campaigned for Bob Dole. He campaigned for Pat Buchanan, and I freaking loved it. Was really, really, really into it. But I was just kind of like, I was kind of a history guy at that point. I liked history. I liked some politics. I liked economics. And it wasn't until I got older, until I got maybe in my early 20s. I say older. I got in my early 20s. I really, really got interested in these things and became more and more libertarian. It was really the influence of Rand and Milton Friedman, and then Hayek and Mises that really, really influenced me. Probably philosophically, Rand probably influenced me more than anybody. And do you know Stefan Molyneux?
Oh,
annoyed when people call it a cult. What's that?
I don't necessarily think it's just old, but just, you know, very, you know, old, sexist, you know, dirtbag. Just say it nicely.
Who's the sexist dirtbag?
Stefan Molyneux.
Oh, do you think he is, really?
I think he's very sexist towards women. I don't really like listening to him.
Oh, God, I love Stefan. And I don't think he's sexist at all. I think he's just like, I think he's right about most things. He's taken Rand and he's built on Rand in a way that Rand refused to. She refused to even like consider voluntarism or anarchism. She actually, in several of her speeches during the Q&A, she actually disparaged the anarchist in a lot of different ways. But no, I love Stefan, and I actually happen to agree with him about a lot of the issues confronting men and women. But really, if you want to get down to sexism, I mean, I honestly think there could be a great case made for there's more sexism against men now than there is women.
I think that there's not necessarily more sexism against men. I think we're just becoming much more aware of it thanks to things like video cameras and the internet. More men are coming up about it. So I think it's probably equal to 50-50. I mean, for the longest time, we always assumed that domestic violence victims were women, but now we're finding out that due to more realization and more upfrontness about this, that no, men account for half, if not, you know, slightly more than women. And it doesn't necessarily have to be physical abuse. It could be mental and emotional abuse.
Oh, absolutely. And there's not enough time really to delve into it. And I won't even try because I don't have like the numbers, statistics, and all the information in front of me. But I would encourage you, just as a challenge to your belief system, pull up Karen Straw. She spoke, I think, at Porkfest. It was one of the Liberty Festivals she spoke at a year or two ago. And the title of it was Socialism in Panties, which was a stupid name for it. But basically, and she even admits that during the speech and says it was voted on, and somebody else picked the title for her speech. But she basically goes through point by point and shows how men, especially within the court system, are often ruled against simply because they're men. And she goes into all this detail about how sexism really has been used against men. Men are really the victims of it now. And I'll tell you, being a divorced guy in this modern world and having kids with a woman, that the court systems do look upon the female much more favorably than the male. There is a lot of bias in the system that is towards the female. And she even goes into something, you know, and I know this to be true. If a woman feels, quote unquote, threatened, they can claim that as domestic violence now. All they have to do is say they feel threatened. Now, the man doesn't have to physically actually abuse her or do anything, but just feel threatened. So you've gotten to the point in the society where I think men have been told, don't be men. Like, for example, women cannot even tolerate when a man gets angry. I know this from my own dating experience. I'll get angry about something, and it's like a woman just freaking has a meltdown about it. Like, you're not even allowed to get angry now. You're not even allowed to be a man. But women, I think it's totally acceptable for them to act much more like men. And that's something that's okay, but yet men aren't allowed to be men anymore. We can't act like men. Because if we do, then we're, you know, horrible and mean and abusive, and we're these terrible people. I would encourage you, though, honestly, because I don't want to go through all the debate here just because we don't have time constraints. But if you pulled that up, it's 45 minutes. Well worth the listen.
Okay. Yeah, and I mean, again, you know, I know you want to be a little bit more time conservative about this. I mean, it's interesting that you say that women are encouraged to be more tough, that we're supposed to be, you know, bitches, and we're supposed to have, you know, a huge backbone and be mean and aggressive, and men aren't allowed to be men. I would kind of argue with you on that point. I mean, I think men are just, you know, they're supposed to have they're not supposed to have a soft side. Like, they're supposed to just be manly and be tough and not really show their weak side. Whereas women, if we show our weak side, we're automatically portrayed as weak instead of just human. Because you know what? Humans have emotions. Humans are going to cry. I have seen men cry. It sucks, but that's what makes them human. I don't look at him any differently than any other man. It just is like, oh, well, geez, you know, that dude just really went through a really awful time. He lost someone or something really bad happened to him. I don't look at him any differently, and neither should anyone else.
Well, you know, on that, I mean, I would agree on that specific point that, yeah, I mean, people do get emotional. I think the problem is that sometimes in this society, men and women both are conflicted. I know this from my own personal experience. I dated a girl who was more of she was a Republican, but she thought of herself as a modern-day conservative woman. But yet, I mean, she really was a modern woman. She wanted to make certain decisions and et cetera. And that's fine. I don't have a problem with that. But I thought it was interesting that she wanted this modern feminist type relationship. But at the same time, she would be like, well, you're the man. Just make the decision. Well, wait a minute. If I make the decision, you're going to get ticked. I think it also, the whole society, it puts us in a situation where no one really knows what their roles are and everyone's confused. Like a guy sometimes wants to say, because it's his natural impulse, X, Y, Z. But he feels reserved because he's like, well, I don't know if I can say it because I'm going to come off like an asshole if I say that. You know, she's going to think I'm being overbearing. And so I don't think you get to a point where no one can make a decision. And I mean, and it's not just one woman. I've had many women say, well, you're the guy, just make the decision. But now if you make the decision and they don't like your decision, there's going to be hell to pay.
Yeah, absolutely.
But look at that. You don't even disagree. You're like, absolutely. Yes, there will be hell to pay. You better make the right decision.
But, you know, when you also mention that the courts most favorably look upon the woman, I mean, it is very true. The court systems are certainly very, very sexist because, obviously, the mother is the one that birthed the baby. She should have top priority because there's no such thing as an unfit mother. I have only known one case in my entire life where I've known someone that lost for custody when she was going through divorce of her child. The reason was that in the same month, she lost her mother and was diagnosed with breast cancer. You're going to be pretty messed up when you're going through a huge life change, knowing that your life is on a time clock right now with cancer, on the fact that you just lost your mother. Of course, she's not going to be mentally stable. So I can kind of understand how the courts ruled against her and allowed the father to have custody. But you are correct. In most of the cases, it is usually favored upon the woman to take custody of the children because, you know, again, women can do no wrong when it comes to that. And it's interesting to note that's why the Jewish lineage is matriarchal, because they always know who the baby's mother is, but they don't always know who the father is. I think that might have some sort of root cause in it.
Well, you know, I think that the system is set up now so that unless the mom is caught doing crack rock, you know, you're not going to get the kids from her. She's going to have to be, you know, clinically insane or be drugs or be a prostitute, and then maybe the courts will give you the kids. I mean, it's just, you know, it's the way it works. And, I mean, I'm a fairly traditional guy, so I actually, in any divorce case that there is, I would always prefer that the woman take care of the children. I just think that makes the most sense. Now, of course, everybody's going to have their own various situations, and I'm not going to sit back and judge and say, oh, you should have the kids or you shouldn't have the kids. You know, everybody's got to work that out for themselves. But I do think it's this tendency to always say, well, unless the mother is like this horrible creature, she always gets the kids. And I don't know if that's technically the right way to go back, especially when you get the government involved. Now, if between the couple, you know, or the, you know, the spouse and the ex-spouse or whatever, if they decide that, that's fine, you know. But that's what I'd like to see it go back to. Like, when I went through my divorce, I would have loved to have had an arbitration. So you go in there and you can't leave the room. You have two impart third-party arbitrators, and you can't leave the room until you'd set on everything. And at least that way it's somewhat voluntary. As it is now, the courts just hand down their decree, these men in dresses, and tell you the way in which things are going to be. And that really drives me crazy.
So what you're saying is that you would, you know, you think it's okay for them to automatically have favoritism over the female, then, is that right?
Well, no, if it's voluntary, that's fine. Like, for example, if it was all arbitration and it tended towards the female just from naturally, and I think it naturally would, then I'm totally fine with that. But if it's forced, then I have a problem with it. And I think the problem we've got now is it's a one-size-fits-all solution, and it's basically just decreed by the judges or statute or whatever, and they decide that this is the way it's going to be. You know, I've been through this personally, so I know a good bit about it, and you know, basically they just read off, this is the way it is, you're going to pay X amount in child support, you'll have shared custody, unless the female protests the shared custody, you have shared custody, you'll get visitations on the weekends, have you already agreed upon, you know, the holiday schedule, et cetera. And the judges kind of go down the line. They don't really care. You know, they got another case coming. But I think it would be much better if it was voluntary. Why is that funny? They don't care. I'm serious.
It's just funny. Voluntary one of letting women in charge. Okay, let's do it.
Well, no, I mean, well, I will admit, and I would probably be called a chauvinist, but I would totally admit that there are situations where I think a woman is better suited, and then there are other situations where the man is far better suited. For example, men have a crap about anything when it comes down to survival. And so men have this way of cutting off their emotions and just saying X, Y, Z. And they don't care who gets hurt in the process. They don't care what happens. All they care is, okay, this is like this instinct. And women, I think, would want to freaking form a committee. Oh, we're about to be eaten by sharks. Let's form a committee and let's talk about this. And a man would be like, no, there's not time for a committee, okay? We need to do this, and that's it. And so I think in that situation, a man is obviously better suited. But like when it comes to raising children, where you need caring and nurturing, I think it's obvious that for the most part, women are typically more caring and nurturing. A man is like, okay, you're bleeding. Duct tape that up and you'll be okay. You know, just suck it up. You'll be all right. And a woman's more like, oh,
sounds,
it's okay. You know?
Right. Well, sure.
Am I going the natural?
No, I mean,
yeah.
you are.
So a woman in that situation
that
should definitely be in charge of that.
Sure, yeah, you know, we tend to be, like, way more nurturing. Even when we don't have kids, we tend to, like, really nurture our friends, especially our guy friends, make sure that everything's okay. And if you mess with us, especially if you mess with, you know, like, our pets or someone that we really care about, I mean, you know, mama bear is coming straight after for you. I mean, the most dangerous thing in the world that you can probably counter against is a mother animal and her babies. Like, if you see, like, any sort of bear cubs, you better back away because your death is coming.
Oh, yeah, I've got buddies' wives that are totally like that, especially because there have been certain long stints of my life where I've been a bachelor. And they're always like, oh, hey, do you want something to eat? You know, do you need this? Are you okay? You doing okay? You know, do you want to, you know, they're always like, you know, very nurturing. And my sister's the same way. She's like, oh, do you want some coffee? I'll make you some coffee. You know, it's funny, like, as we get older, she turns more and more into our mom. But I've noticed that about women in general, even when you date a woman. Like, if you don't have a kids and you're dating a girl, it's like they want to nurture you. Like, it's weird. Sometimes they want to mother you. And you have to tell them, well, wait a minute, okay? Don't mother me, okay? Don't tell me that I need to do this or that. Just, you know, be the girlfriend, you know? Don't be the mom right now. But, you know, I think it's this natural instinct where women just, like, want to be nurturing and caring, which is great. It's fantastic. I mean, as a guy, I mean, and being in a good relationship with a woman, it's great when you meet someone who wants to be nurturing and caring. Who is it? The worst thing in the world is to be with a woman who's not nurturing and caring. That's horrible.
I know there are women that are.
The man is going to be jealous right now because we never talk about relationship stuff like when we're doing the show. And she's always like, we should talk about some of this stuff. See, Nana, she. A man's going to be totally jealous. She's like, what did you do? You got him talking about this stuff.
Yeah, she's going to be kind of like, oh, hey, you got John to talk about things that aren't necessarily politics. I'm so proud of you.
Yeah, it's a rare occasion. It's very rare. I have had a couple Negra Modellas, so I will admit to that.
Hey, I'm on my only rock star for the evening because I've been trying to only cut my energy drinks to only one per day so that I don't freak out and get really overly hyper. So I'm on my first and final one of the day.
Okay, it's 8:30 at night and you're drinking a rock star energy drink?
Hey, caffeine does not affect me like you think it was. I drank a full thing of coffee.
Oh my God, how old are you?
Half an hour later. I'm in my late 20s. I drank a full thing of coffee, like a 24-ounce coffee, fell asleep within 30 minutes.
You're in your
out.
Late 20s? You're in your
I'm
late,
in my late
20s. That means you're 29.
No, that means I'm 28, actually.
I was close enough. If a woman ever says they're in their late 20s, that means they don't want to say I'm almost 30. And I don't want to say what age they are, which means makes them really close to 30.
Hey, has this turned into the Make Fun of Danica show? Because this is not cool.
Hey, I'm 36, okay? And I'll tell you right now, if I drank a Rockstar energy drink at 8:30 at night, there's no way in hell I'd be going to sleep anytime anytime soon. I mean, it'd be like 4 in the morning. I'd be like, So I have to, like, cut off caffeine. Like, it's funny. My sister, I was talking about being motherly. I watched my two nephews earlier today. And she got back in because she's pregnant with number 3. And so she had to go to the doctor, do doctor's visit, get the whole ultrasound thing done. Yes, she's on number 3. But this is the last one. Even though number 2 was supposed to be the last one. Anyways, this is the last one. So she gets back. She's like, oh, you watch the kids for me. I'm so appreciative. And she was super appreciative. She was like, why don't I make you a coffee? And I was like, all right. And she has like this nice espresso machine. And I love Americano. So she was like, I'll make you an Americano. I was like, it's 1:30. I was like, okay, you twist my arm. Because I love Americanos. But even at that, at 1:30, I'll probably be up till midnight or 1 o'clock without a problem. Because, I mean, I don't know. When you get old, you can't drink. Like these kids who drink 3 freaking energy drinks and then go to sleep. Well, how do you do that? Like, how are you going to sleep tonight?
You know, I'll tell you a story. And, you know, yes, this has to do with the fact that you're old and that it still doesn't affect me. But caffeine makes me more alert.
I'm
it doesn't
old.
Necessarily
you're not that far
inhibit.
Behind me, sweetie.
You're still older than me, and that's what counts. There is also a generation gap between us, so remember that.
That's true.
That make you feel old. But anywho, it makes me more alert. It doesn't prohibit my ability to sleep. So I had 24 ounce coffee the other day, and I was still feeling like really, really tired. I was able to go take a nap, no problem. So caffeine doesn't prevent me from being able to sleep. But at one point,
wow.
I was working with a personal trainer, and, you know, this is, like, completely stupid on my part, but I said, you know, I was thinking of maybe looking at some supplements to help out to speed boost my weight loss. Can you help me out with that? And she's like, well, let's just stick to diet and exercise, and if you still feel like you need it, we'll revisit in, like, a week or so and see how you're doing. But me, of course, I'm very impatient, so I went and I got some supplements. Now, the supplements contained about 1,000 milligrams of caffeine, which is equivalent to about 10 cups of coffee. And I had to take about 3,000 milligrams of caffeine per day. I had so many panic attacks. I had so much anxiety that I was shaking. I was freaking out. I was sweating all the time. So I had to stop taking that.
Now, what was it that you took?
It was about 3,000 milligrams of caffeine a day.
Now, was this a pill or just total, like, things that you drank?
No, it was a pill.
Yeah, I can imagine 3,000 milligrams making you freaking crazy.
Yeah, it was pretty nuts. So I was like, okay, I'm not taking any more caffeine supplements, and the only caffeine I'm getting is from one energy drink a day or from a couple of cups of coffee a day.
Yeah, you got to cut that down. You know, I got to the point where I was drinking a lot of these Monster, not the energy drinks, but have you seen the Monster coffees? It's basically the same thing. It's a coffee version.
Yeah, I've seen the coffees. They're not bad.
Oh, I love those things. I got addicted to them for a while. I was like, okay, I got to cut these out. Got to cut them out. Okay, we've got 25 minutes left. We've only done one commercial. one thing I did want to talk about was... I don't know. Where am I now? I'm off. The secession petition. Or not petition. I'm sorry. The secession. Have you seen that?
Yeah. You were talking about it earlier, and I did a quick search for that. It's awesome that there are so many states that want to jump on the secession wagon.
Yeah. You know, I mean, my thing is, if you're part of a union, if you can never leave it, then you're not truly free. That's almost like being married and saying you can never leave the person, even if they abuse you. You're not allowed to leave. And so it's funny, people, the current view of most Americans is that you're not allowed to secede, nor should you be allowed to secede. And I've always thought it's an interesting proposition. If I ever told somebody that, well, listen, we're going to get married, I'm going to beat you, and you're not allowed to divorce me, what do you think about that? Which, of course,
I'd be like,
you would imagine.
What?
Yeah. Oh, sign me up. I'm ready for that. You know, you can do whatever you want. It's only the freedom to leave that makes you free. If you don't have the ability to leave, you're not free. But this secession poll was so interesting because they did it by region. And in the Southeast, which doesn't shock me at all, 25% of people in the Southeast. So this is Georgia, South Carolina, Florida, Tennessee, Alabama, Louisiana. These states all think, Arkansas, these all states all think, heck yeah, we should be able to secede. But what really shocked me was 34% of the Southwest believed we had a right to secede. And this was Texas and Oklahoma, New Mexico and Arizona. 34%. I mean, isn't that crazy?
Wow. About time.
I'm about to say, maybe you're not as shocked as I am. I was blown away by this. But it is Texas now.
I didn't
now.
Think we were more vocal about it.
Maybe. 22% of the West Coast was for it. And this is California, Nevada, Idaho, I think Washington. Am I looking at the map right? No, not Idaho. Idaho's part of the Rockies. But still, 26% in the Rockies. 21% in the Plains, 22% in the Great Lakes, 21% in Mid-Atlantic states, and then 19% New England. That didn't surprise me at all. That the lowest numbers came from New England. But one in four Americans said they would support secession.
That's a start, I suppose. I wish it were more, but that's a start.
Heck yeah! I mean, I'll take that 25% a quarter. It's kind of like Scotland. It barely didn't pass. Independence barely didn't. What do you say to the people? I think there's 1.8 million people in Scotland right now. So, not quite a million people. We want to be free and independent. From a political standpoint, what do you do? I mean, what do you say to that? I mean, that's huge.
I was saddened and shocked because, I mean, I've been reading a lot of the Outlander novels, and for those that may be fangirling about this, it's on Stars as well this month. But basically, it's a historical fiction, and it talks about the last time that Scotland fought for independence, which was 1745, and a huge battle at Culloden. And think Braveheart, but, you know, years later. And it turned out to be a huge bloody mess. Unfortunately, the Scots lost at a huge loss to their nation, as did the Brits, and Scotland was under, you know, Britain rule. And now they had a chance to get their freedom, and, you know, just slightly over half people said no. Like, here was their chance in over 200 years to gain their freedom. I really think that probably the reason why Lenore said people were nervous about starting over, you know, starting anything, you know, what kind of currency would they adopt? Would they probably couldn't go to the pound. Were they going to adopt Bitcoin?
Well, believe me, the media did their job of, well, the media did their job in that. When you were talking about that, what kind of currency, all the fear mongering about the currency. Oh, what currency will they use? They could have continued to use whatever currency they wanted to. I mean, look at Zimbabwe. They went bankrupt and they just dumped the Zimbabwean currency and they went to the dollar. Now, of course, there's nothing the United States can do that Zimbabwe is using the dollar. They could have kept doing that. But one thing I did want to backtrack on is I looked at the population. It's 5.2 million. I don't know. I was thinking it was 2 million. It's 5.2. So basically, about 2.5 million people voted for independence. I mean, that's a lot of people to vote for independence.
Yeah. Wow. Do you think that now was this a real election or was this just polls like asking every single Scot on the street that they could?
No. It was democratic. They had it on the referendum. They were going to, if it passed, they were going to become their independent country. And what's interesting about that, and this has been going on in Europe for quite some time, the last 50 years, there has been peaceful secession movements throughout Europe. Pat Buchanan, about 6 months ago, did an article about this, and he went through and detailed all the different countries that had split up over the years, over the last 50 years in Europe, that was completely peaceful, it was democratic. He decided, well, you know, look at the Soviet Union. They're a great example. They broke up in all sorts of different countries. Now, it wasn't technically democratic, but the point was that no war was involved in that secession. And so you can't have secession without war. And I think the problem in the United States is that people automatically equate secession with, oh, we'd have to go to war with each other. I mean, even when the South seceded from the North, which I believe was completely legitimate, they did not have to have a war. When we seceded from, I say we as Southerners, which I am a Southerner, when we seceded from the United States, we basically told the federal government, listen, we're no longer part of this union. We no longer want to be part of this union. And actually, South Carolina formed the Second Palmetto Republic because we were the Palmetto Republic before. Then we voluntarily joined the union and became part of the United States. When we left it, we became the Second Palmetto Republic. before we joined the Confederacy. But at that point, we had told the federal government that they needed to remove all their people from the military, from the federal military installations at the various forts, and they basically refused to. And that's when we fired on them in Charleston, and that's what really started the whole what I would call the Second Revolutionary War. I would never call it a civil war, because the problem is people call it a civil war. It was never really a civil war. Civil war is when two factions fight over control of the central government to take control of the whole of the country. That never happened. Like, the South never marched on D.C. to take control of it, to control the entire country. So we actually had a war of secession, or a Second Revolutionary War, which you could even say actually the Revolutionary War we had was really a war of secession, because the 13 colonies seceded from England. So, not to get too technically historical there, but I mean it drives me crazy when people say when they call it a civil war. It was not.
So you would consider it an American Revolution, even though the original American Revolution was against England, also not paying English taxes, and you would consider the North and the South fighting also a revolution, not a civil war. Can you explain that to me?
Okay, now are you talking about what people often refer to as a civil war, that? Why I'm not calling it a civil war? Okay,
right,
the reason why it wasn't a civil war, well, during a civil war, and Europe's had many civil wars, is when two factions, two different competing contingents, fight over control of the central government. Whoever wins takes over the government and therefore takes over the country. That's a civil war. A war of secession is when, or a war for independence like we had, is when one part of a union basically separates himself. So when we were English colonies and we declared our independence through the Declaration of Independence, which actually happened on the 2nd, not the 4th, but that's basically we seceded from England because we were part of the English colonies and we said we're yours no more, we're our own separate independent country now. We are seceding from you. They didn't use that term, secede, but that's what we did. We seceded. So, and the same thing happened with the South. The South basically told the United States government, we're no longer part of this union. We dissolved the political bands that have held us there. Which, what boggles my mind is people see us dissolving the political bands between America that we know now and England is completely appropriate. Yet a lot of people don't see it as appropriate when the South and many of the Southern states dissolved the political bands between them and the United States, between them and D.C. But it was the same thing. It was a war for independence. It was a war for Southern independence is what it really was.
Well, okay, then agree that Southerners had just as much right to secede from the nation just like anyone else. But, I mean, Britain kind of – so here's the Revolution. Britain owned the U.S. and, there was American Revolution because they didn't want to be governed by English anymore. They wanted to be their own country. So they, fought for their independence from it. Whereas, the North and the South were in the same nation when they fought against each other. That's, kind of the same way between, North and South Britain. If they were to fight, that would probably be considered a civil war because it was within its own country. Kind of like the Civil War, which I know you don't want to call it that, was in its own country as well.
Well, the difference there is you got to go back to attitudes and people's perspectives at the time. And at the time, if you look at the American colonies, they considered themselves British citizens. They were part of, they were under the crown. They understood this. They accepted this. Part of the British Empire. So there wasn't a whole lot of difference in attitudes. Many of the people who lived in the United States at the time, or lived in the colonies at the time, wanted to make amends with Britain. So when they originally started a lot of what ended up becoming the revolution, they really at first didn't mean to really revolt. The initial thing was, hey, we're good British citizens here. We just want to be treated equally. Well, Britain had a different viewpoint of the American colonies. They saw the American colonies as their subjects, and they also saw the American colonies as kind of a dumping ground for undesirables. So the English didn't have a lot of respect for the Americans, and the first generation of colonists really kind of understood this. But after the second, third, fourth generation of American colonists under British rule, they saw themselves as Englishmen. They saw themselves as having every right of every Englishman, and they should be treated that way. They should have the same rights under the Magna Carta that people who lived in Britain did, because they were part of the British Empire. So from that perspective, there really was no difference. I know the example you used was Southern England versus Northern England, but the English colonies versus England, they all saw themselves as English people. They didn't see any difference. And actually, when it began, they didn't even want to technically revolt. They just wanted basically to be respected. They wanted England to recognize them as Englishmen and recognize the rights that they had and give them the respect they deserved. Now, England, on the other hand, thought that, well, hey, look, we're not really asking this too much here. We passed this tax. This tax is to pay for a war which nearly bankrupted England at the time. That was what they referred to as the 7 Years' War, or the French and Indian War, which British and American colonists, or British colonists at the time, fought together side by side in the 7 Years' War. They fought against the French and the Indians. So England basically thought, or Great Britain thought, hey, what we're asking from them is completely legitimate. We just want them to help pay for this war. And that's also, coincidentally, what helped us defeat the British. It's because we fought with them side by side during the 7 Years' War just a few years prior to the Revolution. So I'm trying not to get too historical about it. But yeah, so there's not a lot of difference in what we did separating from England and what the South separating from the North.
Okay. I guess that makes sense.
I try not to get into esoteric historical debates, because I think sometimes you lose people and maybe you don't convince, and nothing ever gets decided from a historical debate. But I'm just trying to lay out like the history of, you know, this is not something new and crazy. Even Scotland, you know, leaving England, not that crazy. I mean, William Wallace, you know, in the 13th century defeated the English on their own ground and, you know, basically won Scottish independence, but it was only temporary. Well, he didn't win it, but Robert the Bruce won after that. If anybody in the film Braveheart, then they're familiar with that whole story. But that whole story is based on, it's not exactly accurate, it's Hollywood, but, you know. But basically the Scottish have won their independence one time. Well, I mean, sometimes there are certain dramatic elements, and this is another thing, I love film, but there are certain elements you need to make a film interesting and fun and enjoyable, and so they take certain liberties with the storyline. So, but the basic story is actually fairly accurate. They did actually behead him, and they did rip his body into pieces and send it to the four corners so that would tell others that decided to revolt that this is what we're going to do to you. So,
yeah, it's very sad that it had to happen. And on that note, Hollywood's notorious for, you know, totally taking a story and giving it very, very, and I mean, like, extremely different background. Like, the whole Sacagawea story, they made her and Lewis of Lewis and Clark have, like, you know, a romantic relationship, but then they couldn't have a relationship because she's an Indian and he is white, and it just wouldn't write. And it's like, no, that didn't happen. They were both married, and she was there with her husband. It would never work out. It wouldn't happen. Stop it, Hollywood. Just stop.
Well, you know that William Wallace supposedly has an affair with the Queen in the film, and there are a lot of historians who debate that point and say, well, actually, the Queen would have been far too young, because when she married the King, which he had no intentions of, you know, impregnating her, because the rumor was he was gay, but she was like 13 at the time. I mean, I guess it's still feasible. I mean, but, you know, in the film, of course, they portray her as much older. She's like in her late 20s. Gorgeous. Yes. She's actually played by the French. I think she's a French actress. Her name is Sophia Marceau. Beautiful French actress. Good Lord.
Yeah. The actresses there were great, and you know, she would have been like way too young, but. You know, girls, you knew that, you know, the younger you were, the better, because people didn't live very long, and they certainly did not know how to have proper child care. You know, many women died in labor, so.
Yeah, they wanted them as healthy as possible, so 13 was totally normal, which we think is weird today. But
well, you know, there, you know, there was a story where there was a little girl that had consensual sex with their 13-year-old boyfriend and got pregnant. So, you know, they can still get pregnant at that age.
Yeah, so that's something I try to put out of my mind. I have a 14-year-old daughter, so I think about that. I'm like, let's not talk about that. Let's not think about that.
Wait. You have a 14-year-old daughter?
Yes, for my first ex-wife, actually.
Ah, the more you know.
Yeah.
So wait, you had
I'm
when
like,
you were
you know,
12?
No, I'm 36. I was 22 at the time.
Oh, okay.
She's 14. And, you know, actually,
I was feeling old.
I actually signed her up for high school about a month ago. And you don't talk about feeling old. That'll make you feel old right there.
This year was my 10-year high school reunion. I didn't go. I don't even think there even was one. But, yeah, 10 years school ago. And I just checked eBay.
Yeah,
like,
I'm coming up on 20, actually.
On 20, wow. When we were talking
I am.
About PayPal,
it's weird.
They actually signed on to...
You think about this now. You're like, oh, I'll never get to my 20 high school reunion. Yes, you will. It'll happen tomorrow. You'll be like, what in the hell just happened here? Like, what plan
yeah, when
am
we were
I on?
The subject, while we were on the subject of PayPal and Bitcoin, I actually logged on to eBay just to check out the PayPal integration. And I just realized that I started my eBay account 10 years ago, 2014. Whoa.
It's crazy, isn't it? Yeah, my first email address I got was my MSN account. I think that was in 1998, I got my first email address. So that was 16 years ago.
Did you have a Juno address? Because I had a Juno address.
No, I did not have a Juno. I had a MSN, which was basically Outlook, you know, whatever. It was a Microsoft Network. I had an MSN account. That was the first account I ever had. It was a Hotmail account, basically. But you had a choice back then. You could either get at Hotmail or at MSN.com. So I got the at MSN. I was like, that's easier. So I just got – they gave you the choice back then. Now I don't think they even give out MSN accounts anymore. You can't get one. So,
no,
I mean,
I
could be wrong about
like
that.
I don't know. I was just seeing someone at work log on to their Hotmail account, and now it's, you know, been overhauled with Microsoft 2013, so it shows Outlook, but his Hotmail address was still working. I'm not sure what you would need in order to get one. I want to say it's like at Microsoft. You might be able to get like an MSN address, but I'm not sure.
Hmm. Yeah, I haven't tried to get one in years, so I've had mine for 16 years, so who needs it? All right, Danica, we've got 5 minutes. What do you want to talk about?
Oh, man, what haven't we talked about? Okay, you had brought up secession.
Oh, and a lot. There's a lot of stuff we posted we haven't talked about yet. And we have five minutes left, so it's not going to happen.
Well, we can talk about just random stuff or something. I don't know.
Well, you know, I briefly will make a comment about this last trial balloon where Ann Romney suggests Mitt could run in 2016 as allies say he should. And the only comment I have is stop it, please. Just stop. The last thing this country needs is Mitt Romney in office. Well, I don't know. Between him and Hillary, it's a toss-up. And the only reason I vote for Hillary is to bring down the system that much faster.
You know, it would be cool to have Mitt as president just so that he could, like, totally take control of women and, you know, let them, you know, not be able to make their own choices and have everything restricted. No, thank you.
Okay, now explain that comment. That sounded awful feminist.
Basically, he was trying to lobby against women needing all of these, like, permissions to get abortions to, you know, let's not get me started on Rick Santorum wanting to outlaw porn altogether. I mean, just these conservatives just were, you know, they still want their control over women and want to be able to control birth control and choices they make.
Well, okay, hold on one second. Listen to this real quick. You brought up Rick Santorum, and I just have to play this because I hate this guy so bad.
What the federal government's doing is they believe it's unconstitutional, they can go to a federal court and they can take it up in a federal court. There's a process by which we that states can litigate, number one. Number two, there's a process in which states can go to the federal government and get through their elected representatives and fight back through the congressional process.
Okay, that was Rick Santorum commenting on nullification, basically saying it's a batshit crazy idea, and that if you have a problem with the federal government, go to the federal courts, which that's almost like going to the Gambinos on the south side of Chicago and saying, hey, listen, our cousin Vinny is going to mediate this dispute. The problem with the federal courts are they're federal. That's the problem with the federal courts. They're part of the federal government. So if the government steps outside the bounds of the Constitution, according to Rick Santorum, the freedom-hating Rick Santorum, we're supposed to just sit by and hope that the federal judges take care of this. I can't stand Rick Santorum, obviously.
Yeah, you know, I'll mention that Santorum was so hated by many people, Dan Savage being one of them, that he went and I believe made it so that whenever Santorum was, you know, the cause of something that happens during some sort of anal sex. I'm just going to leave that there. You can Google it yourself. I don't want to bring it up on the internet.
I've seen that. You know what? I don't have the best clip of Rick Santorum. I wish I did on the fly right now. It's where he, and I just got told we got 90 seconds, but it's where he talks about, I don't understand this libertarianist right that says, stay out of the bedroom and stay out of the, stay out of my pocketbook, keep my taxes low and leave me alone. I don't know, and this is almost an exact quote, I don't know what kind of individualist society like that has ever existed. And it's funny, Judge Napolitano played that clip on his show Freedom Files one time, and he said, how about the United States? The United States was that, you know, bastion of freedom for individuals where the government stayed out of their way and off their back. Well, anyways, Danica, I got told it was 60 seconds, so it's been lots of good fun, but I think we're at the end.
Yeah, and it makes me sad. I had a very enjoyable time hosting with you. I know that sometimes the feedback and the lag was, you know, we were kind of cutting each other off at some points, but I had a very enjoyable time. I appreciate you doing the show with me and talking Bitcoin and economics and secession. It was awesome.
All right, we'll have to do it again. And for everybody who's listening, you can view us or watch us or listen to us. This will be rebroadcast on Voluntary Virtues Network tomorrow, which is Thursday at 4 o'clock. See you next time.
All right, good night.